Hi, and welcome to Car Corner. I'm Richard Saxon, the coordinator of the automotive program at the Community College of Philadelphia. In today's episode, Dan Reed will be shifting gears and telling us how to maintain our automatic transmission. If you have any questions about our program, please check us out at the website. Thank you, and have a great day.
Hi, welcome to Car Corner. Today, we're going to be tackling a subject that some people are really fearful about: fixing automatic transmissions, and worse, fixing leaks inside the automatic transmission and outside the automatic transmission. But first, let's take a look at some of the basic components that make an automatic transmission work. Automatic transmissions, without a doubt, are probably one of the most mechanically complex parts of the car. They are built with tolerances tighter than a modern engine, and if you're not careful with how you take care of them, they are not going to last very long. So let's take a look at what's involved. First and foremost, we have our fluids. Different types of transmissions, automatics in particular, need different types of fluids. And the most common mistake people make is they just put the wrong fluid inside the vehicle. Putting the wrong fluid inside the vehicle is a problem because it can actually cause more problems than you're trying to fix. First and foremost, a vehicle that's low on transmission fluid, automatic transmission fluid, is going to slip. This happens because the transmission is actually hydraulic in operation. And if you go to add fluid, great. If you add the wrong fluid, though, what's going to happen is that the friction of the materials inside the lubricants is going to affect how good that transmission can actually work. And if you add the wrong type of fluid, you're going to cause improper friction inside the transmission, which may cause slipping, or it's going to cause the internal parts to wear out too quickly, or in an even worse case, it may make leaks occur because the seals are not compatible with the type of lubricant. So I've got four different types of transmission fluid here. And, you know, in a modern vehicle made after probably 1995, you're really going to want to have to check and make sure with the owner's guide, because the universal fluid that they sell at, you know, any one of the auto parts stores or, you know, any place that sells car parts, that universal fluid, while it may say, hey, it's great for your car, the fact is it may be great for your car, well, if your car is 20 years old. If it's a more modern version of that vehicle, just because it has the brand name of the manufacturer on it doesn't mean it's okay. So without a doubt, please just make sure that you put the proper type of fluid in it. And just to give an example, this is a Honda modern transmission fluid. You can only buy this fluid from the dealership. Now that's going to add some cost to, you know, servicing the transmission in the vehicle. But if you think about how much it would cost to rebuild that transmission or have it completely overhauled because you put the wrong fluid in it to save a few bucks, this just doesn't make good sense. These other types of fluids are older types of fluids. They're still used today, but this older design, Type F, was used in Ford vehicles up through the 1980s. And then they went to what's known as Dextron or Mercon type fluid. This type of fluid was really common for all types of vehicles, domestic, imports. We used it in anything that used a hydraulic system. Steering systems, for example, was where we used this a lot. And it worked great for a number of years. This has been replaced by a new standard called Mercon 5 or Dextron 5, and there's also now a version 6 out for different types of transmissions. This one, ATF Plus 2, this one was used in Chrysler vehicles in the 70s and 80s, and now, oddly enough, both Chrysler and Ford, instead of having their own specialty fluids, they went to Mercon 3, Dextron 3, and then later they've actually now branched out into Mercon and Dextron 5 and 6, like I talked about. Honda, again, on the other hand, you know, they're specifying their own fluid, and they have done that for a number of years. But there's other manufacturers as well that really, really use a special type of fluid, and you really want to make sure that you check your owner's manual. A good place to check if you're not sure is just call the dealership and ask the parts department, what do you use in this type of vehicle? And they'll gladly tell you, and I'm sure they'll gladly sell you some too. All right. So after we put the fluid in the transmission, where does it go? Well, it goes through a device called a torque converter. And this is a torque converter. This end of the torque converter right here would bolt to a piece called a flex plate. and the flex plate is what actually attaches to the crankshaft of the back of the engine. So our flex plate is driving this entire torque converter assembly while the engine is running. Inside the torque converter, what we have is a series of vanes. Now what these act like is these act like two fans that would face one another. If you had two fans, two household fans or two box fans, and they faced one another, and you turned one fan on, the other fan would start to spin just because of the air current passing through it. Eventually, they would basically start turning at the same speed after the second fan that wasn't powered up started to spin. That's pretty much what happens inside a torque converter. Fluid is pumped in through the center of the torque converter and it's sent through these vanes. And this side of the engine is, well, it's attached to the engine. So it's always spinning. Even when I take my foot off the brake, it's going to start to allow the fluid to create some friction and coupling and drive these two together as one unit. This is why you can stop a car with an automatic transmission and come to a complete stop at a light. Part of the torque converter inside is still actually running while the other side is not. So the torque converter is, well, it's a device that converts torque and it's got a big important job. Without it, the car would basically stall, and it's one of the main differences between a manual and automatic transmission. This is where in a manual transmission the clutch would be. Basically, in a manual transmission vehicle, you, the driver, act as the torque converter by limiting the amount of torque that goes from the engine to the transmission. In an automatic transmission, hence its name, it's automatic. Okay. So once it comes through the torque converter, it goes through a different piece called a valve body. The valve body, we're going to be able to see the valve body when we take the transmission pan down on our vehicle today. The valve body is basically a mechanical version of an electrical circuit. Instead of sending electricity to and from different objects, it sends pressurized hydraulic transmission fluid to different devices inside the transmission. As these devices apply and release their pressure, they allow the car to change gears. So the tolerances inside this thing are really, really tight. I mean, if you get a chunk of dirt stuck in here and this thing can't slide real easy, transmission either sticks in gear or it doesn't go into gear, and well, then you have a real expensive repair on your hand. One of the most common failures for automatic transmissions is lack of maintenance. If you simply change the transmission fluid when you're supposed to, generally a transmission will last, an automatic transmission could easily last 200,000 miles without a problem. The reason why they fail so often is the fact that people just kind of set them and forget them. They put the fluid in, you know, they figured the fluid went in at the factory. I never saw a leak, so I never had any fluid in it. But we'll see that clean transmission fluid is a nice cherry red color on most cars. When it starts to break down, it gets brown, black, and if you pull the transmission dipstick out on any automatic transmission and it smells what, well, it smells like burnt popcorn, the transmission, unfortunately, at that point is probably too far gone to save, and any type of service would probably do more harm than good. So keep the transmission fluid clean. After it goes through the valve body, it goes through sets of planetary gears and clutch packs. This is a planetary gear assembly, and in a manual transmission, we have gears that switch, and roughly, if you could visualize a 10-speed bicycle, how it changes gears. We mechanically shift from a large gear to a smaller gear. Well, in an automatic transmission, most of them, we have what's known as planetary gears. These planetary gear sets are basically made up of three parts, right? We have the sun gear, okay? We have the planets, and then we have a ring gear around the outside. Now what this allows me to do with this combination of three gears is create two different speeds and a reverse, depending which way I hold or apply these. So if I hold this outer one and I drive with this one, I'll get a speed reduction out of this middle one. And really, that's the beauty of an automatic transmission, and the reason why it's automatic is because these gears are always moving, they're always flowing. And that hydraulic valve body is what controls and applies these devices to let them spin or move, and then that ultimately comes out to drive the wheels of the vehicle. So these planetary gears, these things are pretty bulletproof. They're, you know, unless I'm making a high horsepower car, these things really don't give us a problem. But what fails are the devices that drive them. And what drives the assemblies is this guy. This is a clutch pack. And what a clutch pack is made up of is it's made up of several different layers of steel and fiber. Now the fiber material in here is very thin. It's extremely thin. It's just a surface coating on these steel pieces. What the fiber does is when I apply hydraulic pressure through this clutch pack, it causes all of these fiber discs to be sandwiched down by a piston, and suddenly I can drive them together. When I release the pressure, they can slip, and that's how it's supposed to work. When I apply the pressure to drive a certain part of the transmission, the clutch comes down and engages these guys together. So the reason why the transmission fluid gets burnt or turns from that nice cherry red color when you pour it in to that kind of darker color and possibly a black color is because what happens is as these hydraulic clutches apply and release, the steel is sliding against the fiber. And when you actually apply the clutch, you're actually burning some of the transmission fluid and wearing some of this clutch material down. Eventually, if you don't change the fluid enough, you end up with a whole bunch of basically clutch particles floating around the inside of the fluid, and eventually the transmission fluid will get burned from that, and it, the fluid will get burned, the clutches start to slip, and then before you know it, even a transmission service won't help. So the reason why it's a good idea to change the transmission fluid on a regular basis is because every time that we add new fluid, basically we allow the fluid to pick up more dirt inside the transmission. What happens with the fluid when it gets old is basically its job is to act as lubricant, but also to act as the trash man. And the fluid is designed to actually hold these clutch particles in suspension, and that's why it changes color. Once it gets too full and the trash truck gets too full, we have to get rid of that fluid and add new fluid again. So it's not so much that the fluid gets work hardened like motor oil does. The fluid actually just becomes contaminated. And by changing your transmission fluid on a regular basis when you're supposed to, you're just going to prolong the life of the transmission. There's no doubt about that. You know, to give you an idea, these clutch packs, these steel and fiber pieces, these would be inside this hydraulic clutch unit. And obviously to get to this part to replace these steel and fiber pieces is quite a rebuild. It's a tear down, and it would involve removal of the transmission and a complete overhaul to basically replace this. So that's part of the reason why we're going to change our transmission fluid today. The other reason is our transmission on our vehicle today has a leak. Now what I'm holding here is this is the back half of a transmission. This is called the tail cone section, and this is where my drive shaft would come out of. This seal at the rear of the transmission is a common leak point on most vehicles. What happens is the drive shaft slides through this seal, and while there's no real hydraulic pressure here inside this tail cone section, the fact is if I do have some type of a leak or weepage out here, it's going to cause the transmission fluid level to drop. It's going to cause the underside of the car to get coated with transmission fluid. And in the process, it's just going to cause problems. So since I'm replacing the transmission fluid in this vehicle today, I'm also going to show you how to replace this seal. And it takes not that very long to do. So why don't we get set up over at the car, and we'll take a look at what we're going to do, and we'll move on from there. So now that we're underneath the vehicle, what we're going to do is we have to remove the drive shaft. And the reason why we have to remove the drive shaft for this particular job is because that leaking tail cone section, I have to be able to access that seal. The first step for doing that is removing the drive shaft. Now the drive shaft on this vehicle, this is a rear drive vehicle because it's a Mustang. This is my drive shaft, and then this is the differential. The output shaft of the transmission spins this drive shaft as you drive down the road. The drive shaft is bolted to the differential with these four large bolts right here. So what I have to do is I have to remove those bolts in order to take the drive shaft down. Before I take the drive shaft down, what I need to do is I need to add a mark on the underside right here. So that way I know exactly how this lines back up. Now the reason why it's important is because on this drive shaft there are balance weights, and the drive shaft is balanced just like a tire on a car. If I don't put this drive shaft back in the right location, there's a chance that I would wind up with a drive lamp vibration, and I don't want that to occur. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use some plain old whiteout just as a paint marker, and I'm just going to paint a little mark here, a little white mark on the bottom. And that's going to make sure that when this goes back together, I know exactly where this guy goes. Okay? So now that I got that set, the next thing I'm going to do is I have to break these bolts loose. These bolts are pretty tight. So you might find it useful to possibly use a pry bar, wedge it up into here, and that way I can give this a good pull. There we go, there's one loose. There's three. There's four. And then I can start to pull these bolts out. While I'm taking these bolts out, if I had to at this point, I could replace this universal joint at the back. Sometimes it's a common failure point for rear drive vehicles on high mileage. This car doesn't have a problem with the universal joint in the back, so we're going to leave it alone. But if I had to service it, now would be the time. There really isn't any fast way to do this, and it just takes a little while. What I want to be careful about is when I go to remove this, I don't want the drive shaft to hit me in the head when it falls. It's fairly heavy. Most of them are made out of tubular steel, or some of them are made out of cast aluminum. Some of them for high performance applications are actually made out of either spun aluminum or carbon fiber, which is really high dollar stuff. Get this guy to come in. I want to take this down. It's going to swing. I have to make sure I don't hit any of the components underneath the vehicle, like the exhaust or anything like that. The other thing is where this connects into the transmission at the output shaft, it's going to leak a little bit of fluid. So what I have is on the floor are some oil diapers to catch some of the transmission fluid that's going to come out here. All right, take this down. Slide this down out of the way. And then I'm going to slide this out. Yep, just a little bit of fluid. Okay, so now that we've moved the, gotten the drive shaft out of the way, what I've done is I've put on some gloves and I'm going to start to remove the seal. Quite a bit of fluid came out of the tail shaft section of the transmission, and that's why when the seal fails, it tends to make a mess. It's not a very expensive fix. In fact, this is what the new seal looks like, and it's just a regular old, it's a regular old seal. And you could say it wasn't a big deal to change it. With the tail shaft seal, what I'm going to have to do, though, to remove this seal is I'm going to have to take a chisel and drive it behind the seal, kind of like going in that way. And I'm going to just have to take a couple taps, try to slide this out. It's a little tricky getting this out because the housing is made of aluminum, and I still have the output shaft of the transmission in the transmission itself. So I can't just go in there with a seal puller and kind of yank it out like I normally would. The other thing is when I pull this out, I am going to get a little fluid on me. Hopefully not too much, but it might make for a little bit of a excitement. All right, so let's get started here and start tapping this out. Thank you. you can see I'm starting to push back on this outer seal section. And the idea is, what I'm going to do is try to fold that lip up a little bit and then drive it out this way, basically from the front of the car to the back. All right, and it's starting to slide out a little bit. Get my rag here, try to keep things a little tidy. All right, and there we go, there's my fluid. I'll let that drain just for a couple seconds before I pull the rest of the seal out. If I pull the seal out too fast, what I run the risk of course, more fluid coming out from behind the seal than I really want it to. So just by splitting the seal a little bit, like I've done, and just letting this drip for a couple seconds, I'm just sort of preventing a little bit more of a mess than I mean to make. There we go. There goes the seal, fell into the pan. Okay, so here's my old seal. What I've got with it is basically a set of garter springs on the inside that try to keep a little bit of tension and keep that seal from causing a leak. This is where the drive shaft actually rides through the seal. So this seal, this side that we see from outside of the transmission, this part's actually exposed to the weather. You know, road salt, grime, whatever's underneath the car. So this seal, it's fairly common for it to get worn out over time. So I'm gonna put my new seal in. And the trick is with the seal, is because I have that output shaft of the transmission right there, I can't just use a flat piece of wood or something to drive that seal on. So what I need to do is unfortunately, I need to misuse a couple tools here. And what I have is this great big socket. With this great big socket, I have an old drive on the back that I sometimes use to hit with a hammer. And the idea is to put the seal back on, put the socket on top of it, and then drive it back into the transmission. So let's see if I can get lucky. Take a look and make sure that it's going on square, and it looks like it's going on pretty even. Okay, and that looks like that just about does it. Take a good look at that. And all right. I think that just about does it. So at this point, I'm actually ready to put the drive shaft back in. Don't worry about those drips. They're okay. When I put the drive shaft back in, those drips are going to actually help lubricate the drive shaft seal so that way it doesn't burn up when I start driving the car. All right, so now that we got the seal in, what I got to do is I got to put the drive shaft back in. So I'm going to pick up the drive shaft, slide it back in, and then I'm gonna get these bolts tightened up. So this is the input of the drive shaft, which is actually the output of the transmission, and that's what is gonna go in first. Slide that guy in. Then I've So The other thing is if you remember, I painted those white lines on, and so that way I can make sure that the drive shaft yoke lines up. Now these bolts are pretty critical. If these happen to come loose while you're driving, you've got a real problem on your hands, because what will happen is the drive shaft will continue to spin in the car if it gets any type of lift underneath it. What that will do is that will actually cause this drive shaft to actually kick around and possibly actually flip the vehicle. It doesn't happen too often in everyday driving, but one thing that race cars have is they actually have something called a drive shaft hoop that actually will prevent that from happening, because at real high speeds, if this drive shaft came out, we'd have a serious, serious problem on our hands. The other thing is I'm going to use red Loctite on these bolts. And the reason why is this manufacturer doesn't necessarily call for it, but I just like to use the red Loctite because this is such a critical fastener that I really don't want any chance of this thing ever coming loose. And if you notice, I didn't put it on the bolt that I did the first time. The reason why is because I just need something to hold the drive shaft up while I'm working. So I always do the one with the dot first because I know that's the one I have to come back to put the red Loctite on. And then this guy actually has to come out because I have to put the Loctite on it. Now at this point, what I have to do is, when I'm all done with everything, I'm gonna have to put my pry bar up inside here and get my torque wrench. And this particular manufacturer wants these bolts torqued to about 90 foot-pounds. Reason why I'm gonna wait to do that is because, well, I'm gonna need my torque wrench for another job on this car, and I just gotta go grab it before I do that. So just don't forget, you gotta torque these guys down. Hitting them with a hammer and a wrench isn't good enough, all right? Okay, so what we're gonna do now is we're gonna move on to taking our transmission pan down. So now that we've got that tail shaft seal squared away, we're moving on to the transmission pan, and this is really the heart of the problem for most vehicles. People will, you know, drive a car with a leaky transmission pan because they think it's a big deal to change, and the fact is it really isn't. This is also, for most vehicles, most domestic vehicles, how we change bulk of the transmission fluid. Now, later model vehicles and a lot of import vehicles will actually have a drain plug on the transmission pan, just like a oil drain. That's really convenient. It's so easy to change your transmission fluid at that point. Basically, you drain it out like you would engine oil. You'd only change the transmission filter maybe every 30,000 miles or whatever the manufacturer called for. You put the bolt back in and then fill it up with fluid just like you would motor oil and drive the vehicle. This vehicle is a little more difficult. It's pretty typical of a vehicle, a domestic vehicle made in the 90s with a large square pan. And there's actually 14 bolts that run around the perimeter of this pan. There's no real special technique to taking this down, except that I have to remember that this pan is filled with fluid. So what I'm going to do is when I get to a certain point, I'm going to call my student over, and he's going to help me take this pan down so that way it doesn't make a big mess. But let's get started. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to use an air ratchet to kind of make things go along a little quicker. All right, and what you'll notice is that as you start to pull these bolts down, the pan's going to start to drip. And if you're not in a big hurry, maybe you're doing this on a Saturday afternoon, you can almost pretty much let this drip until it stopped dripping. And then you would know that you wouldn't have all the fluid in the transmission. But we're working under the pressure of the TV show here, so we're just going to keep on going. And there we go. There's our beautiful raining transmission fluid. Let me position this here so I don't get any on the camera. I'm going to let this go until it stops because it's just that much more fluid that I'm not going to get all over the place. All right, so let's let this go. Now, when this fluid's coming out, it's going to be a little bit of a darkish red color. If this were perfectly clean fluid, it would be almost like a cherry red color. This fluid smells, it's got some miles on it, definitely has some dirt in it. So this pan had to come down anyway in order to change this fluid. So just let it go and just wait. At this point, with the fluid coming down, we're just going to have to wait until it slows down a little bit. And that way it'll just be less fluid for me to take down. So now that we've let our transmission rain calm down a little bit, what I've done is I've gotten my student Sean here to help me take this pan down. He's just going to give me a hand so that way it doesn't tip all over the place. All right, Sean, you ready? All right.
that bolt. Got it?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. There we go. All right. Get that drain out. Thank you, Sean. All right, so what do we got in the bottom of our transmission pan? Well, we've got a bunch of sludge. And this is pretty typical of what you might find in the bottom of an automatic transmission pan. There's, you know, the pan's just made out of stamped steel. But what I got in here is basically just residue. And we talked earlier about those pieces of clutch. That's pretty much what this stuff is. I also have a magnet down here in the pan, and this is designed to catch any type of metal filings or any ferrous steel from those steels where we had the clutch in the steel, and that's gonna catch that in that pan and the magnet right there. So the other part I have is up here at the valve body. This is my filter, and then this is the actual valve body itself. This is the underside of the transmission. And if I were to, at this point, take the filter down, which I have a new one to change, more fluid would come out. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go clean this pan out, okay? I'm going to take this gasket off. And while that's happening, I'm going to let this drip a little bit. When I come back, I'm going to take this filter down, and then we'll put a new filter in, put a new gasket on, put the pan back up. So now that our pan's been pulled down, I got the pan cleaned up, the next thing I got to do is I got to take this filter assembly down. Now, some filter assemblies have small bolts that hold them in. This one's actually just held in by friction, and I'll show you something that you have to be careful about. This is my new filter, and let me take it out of the bag here. The filter has this little teeny tiny rubber ring on it. What happens is this filter ring is going to get stuck up inside the transmission. And when I go to pull this filter out, there's a good chance that this ring isn't going to come with it. What you want to make sure of is that when you pull the filter out, if you don't see this ring, the seal ring on here, you're going to have to go up there and just pull it out with your finger or a screwdriver or something. So see if we get lucky. Might also get some more fluid coming down here. So, nope, no fluid. And sure enough, there's no ring. So our ring is stuck up inside here, inside this transmission. Let me get a little screwdriver. Use the end of the socket, try to pry it out. Yep, there it goes. All right, there's my seal ring. Very important to make sure you pull that out. You don't want to double stack these together. If you do, you'll never be able to actually get the filter all the way up inside the transmission. Now the filter, you saw that sludge in the bottom of the pan. The filter is what protects the transmission from sucking that sludge up into the pump and then sanding it through all those clutch packs in my valve body. So making sure that I have a good filter is important. So make sure you buy a decent one. All right, just wipe off this. Try to get this as clean as you can. Sometimes you still have some dripping going on, and you can't really get everything perfect. Just try to keep a clean work environment. Make sure I get that flange really nice and clean. All right, so now that that's cleaned up pretty good, I can move my drain pan down a little bit out of the way. And what I've got is I have my new filter, matched it up, made sure it's the same as the old one. And I'm just going to pop this in, line it up, and then I'm just going to hit it with my fist. And that seal is what actually holds that filter in place. And this is the pickup inside here. And inside this filter assembly, it's basically like a fiberglass mesh, very fine fiberglass mesh that's going to act as my filter for the fluid. Some transmissions, the filter is actually built inside the transmission, and the filter is in there for the life of the transmission. So it's really important with those vehicles to keep the fluid clean. All right. Next thing I have is my pan. I've got my bolts all cleaned up. Lay them down here on a clean towel. And I'll tell you a secret. When you clean the transmission pan, make sure you take the magnet out and clean that too. And when you lay the gasket down, obviously make sure all the bolt holes line up. If they don't, flip the gasket over because it just may be on the wrong side. The other thing is these little tabs right here, a lot of people, well, they don't really understand what they're for. They think they're just kind of left over. But what they do is this is called the third hand. Obviously, I only have two hands. So what would really be helpful is if I had something that held this gasket in place and the bolts at the same time. What you'll notice is that these holes are a little bit smaller than these guys. What that allows me to do is pass the bolt in through the pan. Like that. And now the bolt is actually going to stay in position when I go to put this back up. It's also going to prevent the gasket from falling inside and making a total mess of things. So let me position these guys. The other thing that's real important is that you don't use any type of sealers or RTV silicone or anything like that on this pan gasket. Gaskets like this go on dry. There's nothing that you need to add to make these things work. And once I got these two guys here in the corner, I'm pretty much ready to go. When I go to put this back up, I'm going to have to use a torque wrench, and I'm going to want to alternate as I go back and forth. What I've seen happen a lot of times is the transmission pan is leaking, not because the gasket's failed, but because this mounting flange is bent. And the reason why it got bent was because somebody went a little crazy the last time they put the pan on, and they bent this in the process. The other thing is, at this point, I'm going to take my gloves off because my hands are getting so slippery I almost can't even grab the tools. All right, so here we go. Make sure I got it oriented the right way and put my pan back up. I just want to get the bolts started at first. I don't really want to go and tighten everything down until I'm done. Always remember to finger tighten them first. If you saw the episode on thread repair, you know what's involved with fixing out a stripped hole. I'd have to drill this out and possibly use a helicoil to fix it. All right, so we get the rest of these guys started. And at this point in the shoot, it's probably a lot like looking like it's watching paint dry, as Alan would say. All right, so now that I've got the pan put back up, all I have to do is torque it down. Now, this is a a real important step, and you want to take your time with this. And this is where a lot of transmission leaks actually are caused from, is by not putting the pan back upright. So I'm going to make sure that this guy gets torqued down to 120 inch pounds. Make sure I get my torque wrench set here. And I'm going to basically go on alternating sides to make sure that I don't over tighten anything in particular. Alright, so that finally torques down our pan. That was quite a bit of work, but it's an important step to make sure that all of those 14 bolts don't wind up leaking on us later. At this point, what I would do is I would fill the transmission with the proper type of transmission fluid, and that takes place up with the vehicle on the ground. And also, at that point, I would still check underneath here for leaks. I'd have to start the vehicle and let it idle on this particular model to properly check the transmission fluid level. At that point, what I would do is I might have to add fluid. Now, you saw how much of a pain it was to let this pan down. So the fact is you really don't want to overfill the transmission, because getting the fluid back out is quite a job. Also, if I overfill the transmission, it's just as bad as underfilling the transmission. If I overfill this transmission, there's a chance that I may actually cause the fluid to get air in it, which is going to cause air bubbles, which is going to actually cause my fluid to aerate and have my transmission slip. And too much fluid is as bad as too little fluid, so the level is real important. So when you're pouring the transmission fluid into the transmission, do it a small bit at a time and check it often. And again, make sure you check your owner's guide to see exactly how to check it. And that should just about do it. I'm Dan Reed. Thanks for watching Car Corner. Drive safely. My nose. All right, so now that I got this absolute mess going on the floor, which is a lot more fluid than I actually expected, we should probably cut and take care of that, because that's just getting to be a mess. All right, yeah, way to go, Mr. Reed. That's awesome. A little bit, just a wee bit. You wanted a blooper. I'm a really funny guy.